Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Deepak Fertilisers and Petrochemicals Corporation Limited Q1 FY22 earnings conference call hosted by IIFL Securities Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Abhijit Akella from IIFL Securities. Thank you, and over to you, Mr. Akella.
Yeah, thank you, Nirav. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and thank you for joining us on the 1Q FY22 earnings conference call of Deepak Fertilisers and Petrochemicals Corporation Limited. It's my pleasure to introduce the company's senior management team who are here with us to discuss the results. We have with us Mr. Sailesh Mehta, Chairman and Managing Director, Mr. Amitabh Bhargava, President and CFO, Mr. Mahesh Girdhar, President, Crop Nutrition Business, Mr. Suparas Jain, VP Corporate Finance, Mr. Debashish Kedia, GM Corporate Finance, and Mr. Deepak Balwani, Head of Investor Relations. We'll begin the call with opening remarks by the management team, and thereafter we can open up for a Q&A session. I would now like to hand the call over to Mr. Mehta to take proceedings forward. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Abhijit. I hope my voice is clear. A very good afternoon to all of you. I hope you and your family have taken the second COVID shot and are all safe and sound. I take the pleasure of welcoming all of you for the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call. I also hope you have had a chance to look at the financial statements and earnings presentation that was uploaded on the exchanges on our website. At the outset, I'm quite happy to share that the top line grew by around 37.6%. The EBITDA moved up by 6.7% and the net profit by 7.8%. I would like to share that this is indeed a very good performance in light of the fact that in our raw materials, ammonia shot up by 102%, phosphoric acid jumped up by 49%, our RGP propylene that shot up by 50%. Despite such huge hikes, it's thanks to better capacity utilization, cost optimization, product differentiation that we have been working at, that we could enhance, you know, the margins and improve the fixed, you know, goods pricing to pass on a good chunk of these, I would say price hikes. Typically, the finished good pricing reflects the higher costs normally over one or two quarters. We see that positivity play out in the following quarters also. Now the industrial chemicals grew by, you know, 12%, and the broad, I would say, shift that is happening of specialty chemicals from China to India continues to provide a good boost to our acid business. Though in the acid side, in our Dahej facility, we preponed our scheduled shutdown maintenance because we found a good pocket. That while this quarter had an 18 days kind of planned shutdown, in the next few quarters, you know, we will be seeing the advantage emerging. As far as IPA goes, there was a certain impact emerging out of, you know, the COVID-related disruptions. Fundamentally, we see that, you know, for the pharmaceutical sector, IPA demand and requirement will continue to grow as the pharma sector grows. In the second zone of our businesses, as far as mining chemicals goes, we recorded a growth of 54%. Eldene, which is our top grade premium product, also has improved. We are seeing that, you know, the cement and infrastructure sector is yet to kind of recover back to the pre-COVID days. It's a matter of, I think, a little time. We are seeing that, you know, possibly the second half of the year, post the monsoons, will be something where we will see a positive traction. monsoons, in any case, you know, it's a little low season for the mining sector. As far as the crop nutrition business goes, you know, here we are seeing indeed another very good quarterly performance. And the segment grew by 66.6%. And of course, this is the seventh consecutive quarter of profitability, you know, that we were we had gone through a tough patch. And with the highest ever, you know, our nitrophosphate and our NPK production. And despite, you know, all these lockdowns because of COVID, we could manage over 4,000 digital webinars and reaching out to over 60,000 farmers with our product value proposition. And more, we are now feeling confident as we see the resonance from the marketplace that our conviction in our differentiated product strategy and the way we have put in various other strategies, go-to-market strategies, that this is indeed something that is playing out. And it will be something on a sustained basis that we will see good results. As far as our overall CAPEX plan goes, the ammonia plant that we had planned and the TAN plant in the East Coast, both are, you know, all in good control, running as per schedule. And both these additions, once implemented, is going to solidify the strong foundations of the company and help sustain and enhance our leadership that has been built over 40 years. So now from a larger perspective, I might share that the four-pronged strategies that we have put in place are something that we are working hard at, and we are seeing very, very positive traction. One is to get our size right. And now with our fertilizer expansion already done behind us and doing very good, acid, you know, that we had enhanced our, you know, capacities. There we are seeing it, you know, turn very positive. And similarly, it would be 10. And all of these beautifully aligned with the India growth story. So getting our size right was the first strategy that, you know, we had planned. And that is something that is bearing fruits. The second is that we have invested a lot of energies into building a strong backbone of best-in-class systems and procedures, processes based on digital and IT powers, and that is giving us a strong grip on cost optimization as well as you know, the grip on the marketplace. So that's the second I would say strong strategic drive that we had brought in. The third that we have been working on is this backward integration, which will ensure that, you know, we bring more value into the whole chain, which is something that we have taken up in terms of the ammonia facility. And that is going to be, again, something that will help enhance the leadership that we have in the downstream over the last 40 years. And lastly, and the most important one, is the shift from commodity to specialty that we have started, or from just products to holistic solutions to the final end consumers. And so that in all the three businesses that we are into, industrial chemicals, mining chemicals, and the crop nutrition business, all the three, this drive to move from customer to consumer and providing them holistic solutions, that we are seeing a very strong, very positive traction, and that promises to unfold an exciting future. So on that note, I would like to hand over to Ms. Amita Bhargav, our president and CFO, for a more detailed explanation on the performance of the quarter. Amita?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mehta. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining the Deepak Fertilizer and Petrochemicals conference call to discuss Q1 FY22 results. Our performance during the quarter as as Mr. Mehta was explaining, remained strong despite pandemic-related challenges and significant adverse movement of input prices. This was supported by differentiated product value proposition, operational efficiencies, increased capacity utilization, and proactive marketing strategies. So during Q1 FY22, we reported a total operating revenue of ₹1,902 crores, an increase of 37.6% compared to last year. Our operating EBITDA stood at ₹290 crores, an increase of about 7% YOY. Our net profit for the year recorded a growth of over 7.8% to ₹131 crores with margins of 6.8%. There's been sharp increase in key raw material prices, YOY, and even sequentially quarter on quarter. But YOY, if you see, ammonia prices have gone up 102%, phos acid prices up 49%, propylene, that is RGP, 50%, and MOP up 7%. In the short term, these higher raw material prices have created a headwind that we expect to stabilize over the next few quarters. Now here, government has also been taking proactive initiatives to support fertilizer manufacturers and farmers, for example, increasing NBS subsidy and allocating additional budget. Overall, our net debt, we further reduced it by approximately another 240 crores during the quarter. Finance costs reduced by 22% YOY, driven by continuous reduction of short-term debt due to better working capital management. And our focus on liquidation of products in the fertilizer business from retailer shelves supported working capital efficiencies during the quarter. Manufactured mining chemical business recorded a revenue of 389 crores compared to ₹253 crores same period last year. TAN volume grew by 11% YOY and reduced 12% sequentially quarter on quarter. TAN demand was subdued as the second wave of COVID affected demand from coal, from cement and infrastructure sectors. During the quarter, our manufactured industrial chemicals business recorded a revenue of 318 crores compared to 283 crores same period last year. The revenue grew despite having a high base on account of increased IP realization last year, which was an aberration. The growth was supported by 34% increase in nitric acid volumes. IPA sales volumes declined by 11.2% YOY. Due to the first COVID impact, as you know, IPA prices in the quarter one FY21 saw an unprecedented spike. And as expected, the current quarter has seen an overall softening of IPA prices. Now, nationwide pandemic-related restrictions affected the industry operations and thereby demand of nitric acid products, particularly for the spot market customers. Our Dahej facility also, as Mr. Mehta was explaining earlier, we advanced the scheduled maintenance shutdown for a period of 18 days, which resulted in lower volumes in quarter one. Our crop nutrition business segment continued its growth momentum. And in terms of volume, it delivered a 25% increase in bulk volumes, YOY. Differentiated NPK, that is a smart tech, their volumes went up 39% YOY to 1.31 lakh tons, backed by, again, continued market development activities to create demand from the farmers. Overall, quarter one FY22 CNB revenues increased by 66.6% to ₹993 crores. During the quarter, our IPA plant operated at a capacity utilization of 93%, and both acids and TAN operated at 86% and 103% respectively. In the crop nutrition segment, NP and PK plants operated with utilization levels of 92%. And the bentonite sulfur plant operated at 76% utilization level. The available capacity across our plants, as we've been also mentioning earlier, it gives us headroom for future growth potential. Overall, we remain confident of continuing our growth trajectory while extending full support to our customers, suppliers, and other valued stakeholders. Industry is gradually opening with the reduction in new cases of COVID-19. As a result, demand scenario is likely to improve going forward. I think with this, we'll be happy to take your question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The first question is from the line of Naresh Vaswani from Sameeksha Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Congratulations for a good set of number in tough times. First question, on the raw material side, I presume that the cost would have increased during. So full impact of this higher raw material prices would be reflected in probably Q2 and Q3 as well. So just I wanted to understand realistically how much of this steep rise in raw material prices can we pass it on to our customers. And in the fertilizer segment, this margins, is it high due to the subsidy hike? I mean, what would be the normalized range which we can work with in the fertilizer segment?
So as far as the pass-through of raw material prices is concerned, as you know, see, typically one quarter, and I would say within one quarter also towards the end of the quarter or second half of the quarter, raw material prices hiked very sharply. So in short term, it's very difficult to pass on the raw material prices. In fact, some of the even the contracts which have a provision of pass on of raw material prices typically tend to take the raw material prices of previous month. So as such, in the finished goods, it's difficult to get reflection of raw material prices in such a short time. In longer horizon, and I would say it's typically when you look at YOY numbers in any of the products, you would typically see that if there is YOY increase has happened, and not in a manner that most of the increase happens in a very short time frame. If it has happened over a period of 1 year, typically the pass on of raw material prices it also reflects in the finished good prices. This time it's been an exceptional case in quarter one. So we are quite hopeful, and we are seeing that in finished good prices, where the prices are also linked with the international prices or import parity. Gradually, the reflection of raw material prices is beginning to show. And to that extent, over next few quarters, we should be in a position to get that pass through, I would say, of our raw material prices. That said, it's also right now, it's difficult to predict what happened to raw material prices itself. And to that extent, it's difficult at this stage to put any number to it. Mm-hmm. But it will be sufficient to note that such hikes in raw material prices, sharp hikes, typically would take a little bit of a time to pass through. As far as the subsidy part is concerned, see what happened during the quarter, two, three different, if you look at different forces, one is the subsidy, of course, went up, but equally the raw material prices went up. Also, we, as government had increased the subsidy, post-subsidy increase, we also reduced our MRP. So a combination of all of that is what is getting reflected in our numbers. Going forward, given the kind of increase that have happened, industry is also in discussion with government. So while government has increased the P subsidy, the N and K component has also gone up. And to that extent, you know, our discussions or industry's discussions with the government on the lines of, you know, looking at possibility of increased subsidy on the other component is also right and currently underway. So depending on what stand government takes and what happens to the, you know, also raw material prices going forward, you would see that that impacts the incoming quarters. It's, the situation is so very dynamic that it is right now difficult to put any number or any trend to it.
Mm-hmm. So in absolute terms, actually, EBIT margin, EBIT number in fertilizer is very good. So I was just wanting to know that is it something which is due to our product mix change and internal cost saving measures which we are taking and the operating leverage which you spoke about, and is this something which is sustainable regardless of, obviously government is supporting on the raw material price hikes as well, but I was just thinking that is it a sustainable increase which has happened due to our internal factors or
It's both. As you see, the volumes have gone up, and as we've been saying that with volumes going up, per ton margins improved. Also, the general efficiencies, plant, you know, manufacturing efficiencies go up. So there is an impact of that certainly with increase in volume. There is partly also an impact of subsidy increase. So it's a combination of both.
Okay, sure. And last question, in terms of growth, our capacities are now close to optimal utilization overall, if we see. So how do we plan to grow? Ammonia project is there, obviously. But in each of the segment, if you can briefly explain how will growth come in over next 2 years?
So as far as fertilizer is concerned, we still have headroom, not just in bulk, but even the specialty fertilizer, that is the bentonite sulfur segment. So there is some bit of a capacity utilization that is yet to be exploited. Also, as we've been mentioning that with marginal debottlenecking both on the raw material storage and the evacuation side, the NPK capacities can be enhanced from 6 to 8 lakh tons. So while vis-a-vis 6 lakh ton, while we are, our capacity utilizations are now inching up closer to 90% or thereabout, but 8 lakh tons is there is that headroom available. So that bit of debottlenecking, which is you know, marginal in terms of any capex that may be required. So that's as far as fertilizer. Now, in fertilizer, the other aspect also is that we are also launching cross-specific formulations on nutrients, which is where in terms of volume we would still be restricted by the 8 lakh tons, I would say, but that's a value enhancement product that we are going to be launching from this Rabi season, and that should result in better margin even though volumes may again remain restricted to 8 lakh tons. Maybe I'll ask my colleague Mahesh also to add a few words to this. Mahesh, would you like to just
sure Amitabh. Sure. Thank you very much for the question, and I will not report what Amitabh has said. I'll just give you perspective of the key question here was that how do you see sustenance of the such a great financial performance? So first of all, let's reflect in the last 7 quarters, we have continuously grown our fertilizer business. It's basically based on our launch of differentiated NPK, utilization of our capacity. We also had spare capacity of NP. We also increased our NP share. We also enhanced our specialty business, manufactured and traded both. What has helped us is that we are actually becoming now a kind of not a minor player, but a major player in terms of market share. Like in this quarter itself, we grew our market share by 6 points. In Maharashtra, we went up from 15% to 21%. And So number one, we are able to expand volume. Number two, we have been able to stabilize the growth of our differentiated product based on its value. So this I see going forward sustainably, because this is what we have demonstrated in the last 6-7 quarters. Going forward, as AB already started mentioning about our new formulation, so we are going to launch complete nutrition balanced products going forward, coming in the next couple of months. So we already got approvals, and these products would be launched in some specific crops. They are suited for specific crops better than others. And they would be also completely differentiated, unique products in the market. They will help us further enhance value as well as utilization of our plants. And in the same way, even on our specialty side, we have already launched crop-specific products in grapes, in pomegranate, in tomato. So our strategy of going into differentiation and then consumer-based crop-specific products is actually on the ground, and we are not just talking, we are actually launching those products and are able to scale up. So I can't make any specific comment on the financial outlook, but this is the strategic outlook of the business based on differentiation and based on solution to the crops and based on our working engagement with the consumers. As your chairman already mentioned, that we already established a good business model. Even in the COVID period, we are reaching to lakhs of farmers. We are able to engage, we are able to demonstrate. So we set up a complete go-to-market strategy and a portfolio strategy well, based on these two factors as you mentioned. Thank you very much.
So, as far as the other segments are concerned, TAN, as you are aware, we are looking for an expansion on the East Coast, 376,000 ton capacity. As far as IPA is concerned, as of now, there is no plan for expansion. We are watching the IPA, the entire environment in terms of what are the sustainability of long-term margins. In acid, obviously at this stage, while there is no capacity announced, any expansion announced, but there is obviously the demand growth that we are seeing in the nitric acid downstream segment. That definitely opens the opportunity for expansion of nitric acid. We have sufficient sort of land available in Dahej to do that, but as of now, we haven't taken any decision. But there are definitely growth opportunities on the nitric acid side, given what's have the demand.
So the line for the participant drops. We move on to the next participant. Sure. Next question is from the line of Nishit Shah from Equitas. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir, and congratulations on good set of numbers. Sir, I wanted to understand that. So I understand that we are debottlenecking in PEN. So what kind of investments are we looking at, and what is the timeline over there?
Now, what I mentioned is the 376,000 ton capacity, a new capacity on East Coast.
Okay.
We have in the past also given a guidance that we are trying to freeze the capex number, but it's likely to be in that 1800 to 2000 range in terms of 2000 crores. That's the range, but the exact numbers are being finalized.
That's why I was going through the annual
1000 ton. Yeah.
Sorry, sir.
Go ahead.
Yeah, sir. So I was going through the annual report, and in that it states that we have initiated debottlenecking for 10 capacity expansion at Taloja with minimum investment. So I was talking in that reference.
Yeah, so that is still being studied from a technical standpoint as to what kind of additional capacity it can yield and what are the capex involved. But there is definitely a prima facie opportunity to debottleneck Taloja capacity.
Okay. And so my second question is, I wanted to understand that you said this nitric acid shutdown will benefit us. So can you elaborate what kind of benefits are we looking at?
Nitric acid shutdown.
Yeah. So going forward, that will help us.
I didn't make any statement about shutdown. I'm not clear what are you referring to.
Okay, sir. So can you help me understand what are the current realizations of nitric acid? Are they trending upwards?
So nitric acid, what has happened is, one is a general trend in terms of what is happening in the nitroaromatic segment. That you know, we are now seeing a lot of the global supply chains showing inclination towards diversifying from China to India. And given our in nitroaromatic segment and various specialty chemicals, we are still in many of these segments are perhaps 1/15th, 1/20th of China's capacity. Even a small, I would say, diversion from China could be a significant number on our base. So one trend that we are seeing is that that with that, you will see expansion coming from existing players. Some new players may also enter, and for the existing capacity, the capacity utilization will go up. And that is resulting in the demand on the nitric acid side. But what has happened in Q1 specifically is that because of even second wave COVID-related restrictions, spot segment has seen a reduction in demand. Also, what had happened is some of the other players who are into nitric acid segment, their downstream capacities of their where the nitric acid goes, they were also, because of COVID-related challenges, were not operational. As a result, there was more acid into the market. So an impact of that has been felt in Q1. But directionally speaking, we are, and I've said that earlier as well, that we are seeing that nitric acid remaining short for foreseeable future. In fact, our estimate is that till 2024-25 and even beyond, given what is happening to the demand side, and now we are seeing demand shaping up compared to the supplies, this product will remain short, and an effect of that should reflect in the realizations of the demand.
Okay, got it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Lokesh Manik from Malam Capital. Please go ahead.
Yes. Hi, good afternoon, Amita. My first question was a clarification on which I required on the fertilizer business. We've seen very good margins. Has there been any impact of low-cost inventory coming in from last quarter in this quarter?
Yes, that's what I mentioned, that the numbers are a combination of the capacity, higher capacity utilization, higher volume,
right,
and
right,
also benefit of subsidy.
Okay.
But like I was also mentioning, that there were, as much as there was subsidy, there was also, we reduced our MRP post the subsidy announcement, and some of the effect of raw material prices has also got reflected. So it's a combination of all these three, four things that
okay.
is reflecting. But certainly, yes, that's the...
So going forward, if the raw material prices today are higher, it's at ammonia is at about $500, if I'm not mistaken, would they start reflecting in the second quarter onwards in the fertilizer business?
So see, what has happened is, and which is the point I was earlier making, that the government has increased the subsidies in the P segment.
Mm-hmm.
Has gone up across NP and K raw material prices. And
right.
that's the discussion industry is currently having with the government also in terms of what would be government's take or response on those increases, and would government consider any increase as far as the other nutrients are concerned. So depending on what stance government takes, industry
right.
will obviously look at passing on the prices of these increased raw materials in the finished goods. So we'll have to see. It's I think there are, it's not just what we do and what industry does, but it's also what government does is
correct
key to this question.
Correct. Right. And Amitam, if you can just share what is the inventory or the working capital cycle on an average that we have for different products from TAN to nitric acid, IPA, and NPK. On an average, what is the raw material holding period or an inventory holding period that we follow for them?
For IPA, and so there are at least two products which have a season involved, which is fertilizer and to an extent mm-hmm. even TAN. TAN has this is the second quarter is a lean season because practically
right.
during this period. So the working capital cycle also changes quarter on quarter for these two products. In fact, in fertilizer, we like I think I earlier also said that post the Rabi season, you typically are building inventory till monsoon comes. And so therefore, if you see the working capital cycle during that period, it peaks just before June. And June is when you would get a big chunk of your payment, and the numbers, working capital numbers, substantially change for CMB. For the other products, which is IPA and for acid, we typically have 30 to 45 days of credit period, and sometimes we collect faster than those, particularly in the spot segment, depending on the extent of spot segment. Your working capital cycle could be faster than 30 to 45 days.
Understood. Just a small request, Amitabh, if data disclosure can be consistent, because this quarter we are seeing that nitric acid revenue and IPA has been combined. So in last quarter it was different. If you can just share nitric acid revenue for the quarter and the IPA revenue for the quarter in the investor presentation going forward, as in whatever data we are showing,
we can further clarify that.
Yeah, because while plugging in data, it becomes a little difficult in terms, because you're following a trend, and then you know suddenly if we see a clubbed revenue profile for 2-3 different products, it becomes difficult to analyze.
No, fair enough. We can clarify that.
Right. Thank you so much, Deep. Thank you so much, Amitabh.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepak Poddar from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. So I just wanted to understand, you did mention that the pass-through of raw material to the finished good might take maybe over next two quarters, right? So that's the time period when one should expect your margin to normalize, maybe the impact that we have seen this quarter. So yeah.
So it's as simple as it may sound. See, one is of course the prices, finished good prices have to start reflecting, or the raw material prices increase needs to start reflecting in the finished good prices. Mm-hmm. There is also a play of a particular season. So in certain season, in TAN for example, is a lean season in Q2. Now in Q2, therefore, even though normally, if it was any other period, the reflection of raw material prices and finished would have been much faster. If you have a lean season where the consumptions are low, it could take a little longer. But what if you compare YOY, typically any increase in any of these segments, you would see that unless there is a very, very sharp increase in a very short period, you would typically see that the margins, per ton margins, remain steady. And that is the point you need to see. Quarter on quarter, there would always be, these fluctuations. So even last year also, if you see the way the chemical segment picked up by the second half. So you can expect that as the demand also goes up in these segments, the pass-through of our raw material prices and finished good prices would be far swifter.
Correct. So by third quarter, one should assume that this pass-through should be complete, like by third quarter, by
December? I can't say complete or otherwise, but yes, by third quarter, by third and fourth quarter, you would see obviously much better sort of pass-through of these raw material prices. Mm-hmm. But equally, one needs to watch out what happens to raw material prices. And therefore, if raw material prices remain at that level, yes, that's pretty that statement that we get passed on by third or fourth quarter is a fair statement. But if the prices go down or go up from here, we'll have to see.
That's a fair comment. But do we have any kind of view that how can the raw material prices behave, or it would be very difficult on your part to give any kind of comment on that?
See, right now, given the sharp increases that have happened, we believe that at least ammonia prices should, from here on, the run-up on the upper side, high side should be limited. Phos acid is, in general, phosphatic fertilizer prices globally are going up. And we'll have to see, because these prices get fixed quarterly basis. And also, typically, it's a very, as far as the suppliers are concerned, there are limited suppliers globally. And to that extent, negotiation happens on a, I would say, party-to-party basis or, bilateral basis. So to that extent, we'll have to wait and see what happens in Q3 and Q4 on phos acid prices. But the other commodities have run up already, and we hope that from here on, the further run-up on the higher side would be limited.
Limited, yeah. Fair enough. Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah, that's it from my side. All the way. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Surbhi Sarugoy from SMIFS Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Sir, my question is that in your press release, you have mentioned that you have received approval for nutrient-based subsidy for crop-specific grades by government. So can you quantify the amount of subsidy? What would be the amount of subsidy?
Mahesh, would you like to answer? This is more about product.
Certainly, Amitabh, I can answer that. So, see, the subsidy in complex NPK fertilizer are driven by the NPK. They are declared for N, P, and K, as well as for two micronutrients, which is boron and zinc. So they are the fixed rates, and depending on how much is the use of particular nutrient in a particular product formulation, you can calculate that. So like P has currently the highest subsidy, and K has lower subsidy. In the same way, there is a fixed subsidy for zinc and boron, and no other micronutrients have subsidy. So the formulation which we are bringing in the market going forward are multi-micronutrients, which are complete in their composition. They are providing balanced nutrition for certain specific crops. So accordingly, they would be positioned. So I can't calculate right now, but I think the methodology is based on the NBS nutrient-based subsidy.
Okay, sir. And sir, my another question is that can you quantify how much will be the finished goods price increase in the second quarter to reflect the raw material price increase?
Ma'am,
So when it comes to fertilizer, as I think Amitabh already explained, there's a multiple factors are playing role in the pricing. It is raw material, it is inventory of the raw material, when the price has changed, as well as is there a change in the subsidies in a particular nutrient. As Amitabh already mentioned, certain discussions going on. And accordingly, we decide the MRP of the product, and which are also driven by the reasonableness clause, as the complex industry is governed by certain regulations under NBS policy. So multiple factors are considered when we define our pricing. But generally, I mean, when the raw material prices are changing, they're reflecting into the price changes, unless there is an increasing subsidy. So that's how the pricing takes place. So I can't put really one number because that's very, very dynamic pricing.
Okay, sir. Okay, understood, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Vishal Prasad from VP Capital Limited. Please go ahead.
Hi. So I have a question related to our ammonia capex and the cost structure. So I was trying to go through the conference call transcript for the last call that we had done. So Amitabh, there you explained very beautifully how the cost structure is, but somehow I got confused. So what you said is if we take the natural gas at 220 and conversion at 40, so we will make it at 260 to 280. And the landed cost, if we are importing it from Middle East, is $450 to $480. And that's what I understood. But if we are trying to import it from Middle East, and then our competition in South India, one of the fertilizer company, they said in the last call that FOB of ammonia is $260 to $280. And another part that you said is $80 will be the transportation cost. So it comes to be $360 or something. So is there something that I'm missing? If you could help, Amitabh.
See, first is any number that you take of ammonia, whether 260, 280, 300, 350, that only reflects a point in time what the ammonia prices are. Today, for example, ammonia prices are as high as $650 FOB Middle East. So the way you need to look at ammonia project is that, is this from a cost perspective? Because we have a choice of buying ammonia or making it here. So in buy versus make decision, what we believe is that making makes sense if you are one of the more competitive cost producers of that commodity on at least in the region, if not globally. And that is where I was earlier, I had explained this aspect that while ammonia would go through its cycle from 250 to now 650, you know, it will go up and down. But when we look at our gas prices, if today when we move ammonia from Middle East to our plant, we incur almost $80 to $90 of transportation cost. You translate that into gas, it translates to about $3 per MMBTU of gas price, just from a conversion standpoint. We also have, as I was mentioning earlier, that we have government of Maharashtra under their Ultra Mega project scheme has given us fiscal incentives where equivalent of the state GST that is payable on the fertilizer, that state GST portion would be reimbursed to us over a period of say 15 to 20 years till we recover 75% of our project cost. That, if you translate again into gas equivalent, translates to roughly about $1.25 to $1.50. So what it means is that by producing this ammonia here, you are saving roughly $4.50 of gas. Now, so long as our estimate is that even at the current level of increased commodity prices, the landed cost of long-term gas, and one should not confuse with the gas prices that one keeps seeing on the spot segment, which fluctuates quite a lot, but on a long-term basis, if the gas price or the landed price of gas is about $8.50, and if I am making a saving of $4.50 because of all these factors in ammonia terms, then it's as good as manufacturing this ammonia at a gas price of $4. Now, $4, if you today you want to set up a plant, ammonia plant in Middle East, or any plant that is based on natural gas, the transfer pricing of gas that you would get from suppliers there would not be less than $4, which means that this plant is as good as being set up in Middle East at the source of gas, the cheapest, perhaps regionally speaking, is the cheapest source of gas that is available. And if you compare yourself from a construction cost point of view or a capital cost point of view, typically India from a construction part a point of view is at least 15 to 20% cheaper than the construction cost in Middle East. And that's the additional, I would say, advantage. So long as I am convinced that this plant, I'm setting it up in Middle East at a source of gas which is perhaps the most competitive gas source in the region, then doesn't matter what happens to commodity, I would always remain on a long horizon. I would always remain better off making ammonia as opposed to buying ammonia. Now that, I mean, one can take $650 of SOB Middle East and do this calculation and one would come up with huge number in terms of the delta. While if you look at this from a $250 or $280, then that number would obviously look a different number. Another data point that I must mention here is that in last 10 to 12 years, our purchase of ammonia from Middle East has been on an average anywhere between $390 to $400 of FOB Middle East. That is the price at which we have typically bought ammonia. So you can plug in that number. I mean, for the sake of calculation, one can plug in that number. But we also believe that given what is happening globally in terms of carbon emission and hydrogen becoming a fuel of choice, you would see ammonia also becoming a carrier of hydrogen from a trade perspective, because hydrogen per se cannot be carried. It's a very highly explosive material. So the commodity cycle of ammonia in next 10 years, we believe is going to be different from or more inflationary than what it was in 10 years. But one can apply any of these numbers. But I think fundamentally one should look at it, are you cost competitive regionally? If the answer is yes, you would always be better off making ammonia as opposed to buying it.
Got it. So let's say ammonia SOB is 250, then we just need to add $90 or $80 of transportation. So that will give me the factory discount, or is there anything else that I'm missing?
So I don't know whether I should answer this question, because your assumption on $250.
But just assuming that it is 250, I mean, it can be anything else.
Like I said, the data point is we have bought ammonia at $400 FOB Middle East in past 10 years. The okay. current prices of ammonia are at $650. Now, you apply any number, but if you whatever number you take on top of it, you should apply $80 to $90 as something that we would save. We also have a saving of $40 to $45 because of state incentives being granted to us. And there is roughly about $10 to $12 of saving that we get in steam, because this ammonia plant would export steam, and which has a value in terms of it being utilized in our Taloja facility. So you can apply any of those numbers to your calculation.
Okay, great. One final question. So I was reading your annual report, and we mentioned that earlier 2,900 crores we will spend on the ammonia factory. And then it increased to 4,100 crores. So what happened? I mean, why this extra $1,200? And I looked at the land cost also, it was 120 crores extra for you. So is there something else happening there?
So 2,900 crore was based on an assumption that the existing plant, many of the utilities would be utilized for the same plant. But that is not something that is possible, because this plant is obviously located at some distance from the current plant. Plus, the current plant doesn't have that kind of utility. As the more detailed engineering was done, the current plant utilities are not sufficient for this. number one. Number two, there were a number of other, whether it is related to environmental related regulations, where instead of using the current central effluent treatment plant, we are setting up our own zero liquid discharge. There were also issues of certain water pipeline. There was issues of water storage. There were issues of a power island, separate power island required. So there are a number of factors. But the point remains that at 2,900 crore, we were 30% or thereabout more competitive, because we had got this plant at significantly attractive rate. What has happened with the increase in cost is we are now at par with any new plant that would get set up for 500,000 ton. So as such, from a construction cost of point of view, we are at par with any plant that would get set up today, a new plant that you get set up today, 500,000 ton. And to that extent, we are not at any disadvantage. If at all, there is an advantage that we had earlier, as to an extent has been worn off. Land cost obviously is higher than what we had anticipated, and I don't have to explain what happens in land, in general land procurement. And so those factors always come to play when one acquires the land, estimate versus actual.
Thank you very much. So I'll request you to come back in the question queue for a follow-up question. The next question is from the line of Madhav Marda from Fidelity International. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, good evening. Thank you so much for your time. I just wanted to understand that for our existing products, FY21 was a good year in terms of margins in general across, I think, many of our categories, which showed up in our sort of overall EBITDA margin for the company. Just your outlook for FY22, if you could give us a qualitative flavor in terms of how the margins can shape up across TAN, IPA, fertilizers, and nitric acid, if you could give us some sense versus FY21, that would be really helpful. Thank you.
So overall, what is happening in FY22 versus 21 is, one, fundamentally in FY21, our capacity utilization across, excepting fertilizer, NPK, by and large, in every other segment, we face challenges in maintaining our plants, operating our plants from manpower standpoint, from evacuation transportation standpoint. So there is a headroom of capacity utilization that is sitting in our plant as we closed FY21. And some of it you are seeing the reflection of that in the Q1 numbers, with the exception of IPA. In every other product, the capacity utilizations have gone up. That is number one. Number two, we had certain challenges, operational challenges in the acid, where the Dahej plant for half of last year was running at low capacity. There were energy inefficiencies, which we corrected by second half, by Q3, Q4. If one were to remove Q1 performance in Dahej, where we took a shutdown, an annual shutdown, we preponed it. If you take that, both in Taloja and Dahej, our asset capacity utilizations have gone up. Also, all those anomalies which were there on the cost structure, those have been taken care of. So you would hopefully see better cost efficiencies as far as the acid is concerned, because your capacity utilizations are better, and also some of those energy inefficiency issues have been sorted out. What we also saw from an acid point of view is, while first half of last year was muted because of the COVID reason, but the whole China plus one kind of the demand side that came in nitro aromatic segment from the global procurement standpoint, that effect we started seeing from second half, and this is obviously a post COVID Part of it is the reason is post-COVID, where a lot of global supply chains are diversifying from China, and part of it we are getting the benefit of it, or the our downstream segments are getting benefit of that, and that reflected in the demand as far as the acid is concerned. And so we believe, and I was earlier mentioning that with what has happened to nitro aromatic segment specifically, and the other segments which consume nitric acid, we are seeing, or our estimate is that this product will remain short for a period of time, and that we should get the benefit of that in our spot segment, which would have been the case only for part of the year last year. Fertilizer, you've seen the capacity utilizations are going up, but equally, I think one factor that has also come into play this year is this sharp increase in raw material prices. We are hopeful that I think in the second half of this, we would be able to, or the finished good prices would reflect those increase in raw material prices. And with that, if that happens with the increased capacity utilization and fundamentally demand remaining strong in each one of these products, hopefully the overall performance should not just sustain, but hopefully do better.
Got it. And sorry, anything on the TAN as well, like the margins for TAN for this year? Any flavor on that?
So TAN, one is fundamentally the capacity utilization should be better, because last year we closed with 437,000 tons, which is roughly about, let's say, 87% In previous years, we have, when the demand has been there, we have run that plant at 105-106%. Quarter one capacity utilizations were good, up more than 100%. So if the demand side remains, and that's despite the fact that in each of our segments, that is coal, limestone, and infrastructure, there was an impact of second wave. So we believe that that once the Q2 is out, because Q2 is again a lean season for TAN, Q3, Q4 demand should remain strong, and by that time there is also sufficient time for finished good prices to catch up with raw material price increase. So we believe that, like last year, the second half for TAN should be good in terms of volumes as well as margins.
And my last question from my side would be on the timeline for the ammonia project. That does the timeline remain the same as the last update? Like, when do we expect that plant to commission?
Which one are you talking about?
No, if you could just help with the ammonia and the TAN plant, both of them.
Ammonia is Q4 FY23. That is, let's say, March, April of 23. While TAN is in FY24, the second half of FY24. The construction yet to start, but we are getting all the required approvals that are required to start the construction.
And ammonia plants, you haven't faced any hiccups, hopefully, so far, right? In terms of the...
No. We also, I think somewhere in our quarterly presentation, we've also given certain pictures in terms of the progress it has made on the ground.
Understood. Okay, thank you so much, and wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A request to all the participants, please restrict to one question per participant. If time permits, please come back in the question queue for a follow-up question. The next question is from the line of Manish Jain from Money Life Advisory Service. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. My question is, what amount of...
Manish, your audio is not very clear. May I request you to speak through the handset?
Sorry. Thanks for the opportunity. My first question is, what amount of capex will be looking at in the next 2-3 years? And the second is, what kind of risk are we looking in the near future?
Yeah, on capex, your point on risk is related to capex, you're asking, or that's a general?
No, just in general.
So as far as the capex is concerned, we've mentioned that ammonia is overall is about 4,350 odd crores. We closed the year last year, what, about 1,500 crores. So we have additional roughly in both years, roughly about 1,350 to 1,400 crore each in the next 2 years. In TAN, I just mentioned we are yet to get the exact numbers, but 1,800 to 2,000 crore is one once the construction starts over next 3 years, about 36 odd months. So that's the way the CapEx would pan out. As far as your question on risk is concerned, so fundamentally in our business, one is because fertilizer is dependent on monsoon. Monsoon remains an uncertainty. Last 2 years and this year also, monsoons have been fairly good. So one has to see it one year by year, what happens to monsoon. So I think that certainly remains as one uncertainty or risk. The second aspect I would say is the nature of our raw materials, particularly on the phosphoric acid and MOP, which are critical raw materials for our fertilizer business. In general, from the supply side, it's a sort of an oligopoly or a very limited suppliers are there globally, because the reserve of the underlying rock phosphate those are concentrated in certain regions, and therefore what happens in those regions and it's always when you have suppliers who are limited, there would always be price as well as availability aspects. What we've done from our side is obviously we have tried to diversify these sources and minimize the risk, but there is always a risk. That's the risk we believe it applies to a great extent to the other fertilizer players also. So that's definitely one area that we are. And the third one in our case is we need to implement our projects in time and cost. The good thing is that a large project like ammonia, it's just a construction project now. The entire procurement is 95% of procurement is all done. Land is in place. All environmental approvals are in place. Other statutory approvals are all in place. So the risk of just the construction is in an overall project implementation risk is a limited risk. And to that extent, we believe that with Toyo as our contractor, they have done more than 70% of global ammonia projects they've implemented. With that and a capable in-house team, we believe that we have a fairly good hold on that risk. I think that those are the three areas that obviously we believe are uncertainties or risks.
Thanks for the detailed explanation. Yeah, that's it from my side.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll take that as the last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Amita Bhargava for closing comments.
Well, thank you so much, everyone, for your participation. And for any further queries, clarifications, please do get in touch with our investor relationship team. Deepak Balwani is there. And we keep looking forward to your support in our future endeavors. Thank you so much, and have a safe time. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. On behalf of IIFL Securities Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. You may now disconnect your lines.